my first experience working in mural painting was in Mexico in 1984. And since then, I've been getting involved painting murals, so painting public art. I've been getting involved in doing public art some way or in different ways. And what I have here, I have in my website, you will see different kinds of works, especially divided into easel painting and mural painting. The first experience that I, when I get involved painting murals was through a professor that I get in Mexico that was one of the disciples of Siqueiros. And thanks to that experience, I was able to get involved with what is the community murals movement. That is not a traditional mural movement, because the community murals is more basically what I like to do is to share the experience that I've been having as a painter, as I'm in mural painting. And that has been leading me to a very, very interesting, very rewarding, and very powerful experience when I'm painting murals. The fact that you are involved with the community to paint a mural is a very empowering experience. And now that I'm in the United States, since 1993, and I've been working in Oregon, painting murals, what I've seen is that the increase of the Latino population has been exponential, and it's the population, Latino population, is growing very fast. But in spite of the fact that it's growing very fast, and the Latino heritage that we have in this country, we don't have a voice. I mean, a presence, a historical presence. So my concern is how to bring those voices from the Latino community, and also, if it's possible, from other minorities as well, and bring those elements into the experience of the collective experience of those communities. And I didn't have the intention to develop that kind of strategy when I was painting murals. Basically, I was commissioned to paint murals because murals is a very popular form of art, especially for minorities and in particular for Latinos. Since Mexico was the epicenter of the modern Latino movement, I mean the modern mural movement in the contemporary history. And because of that, I decided to get involved in these commissions, but also to bring the aspects, the historical experience of the Latino community into those murals. So in a way to empower the Latino population, to make a presence, a historical presence, because I've seen that there's always this kind of misperception that Latinos are newcomers and they don't have this kind of real historical influence in the United States. And if we see historically, the Latinos are, or especially Mexico, was a huge influence in the formation of the United States as a nation itself. Because the half of the Latino population, the half of the Mexican territory was taken from Mexico to create this kind of continental nation that was the United States. So the historical aspect of that I like to embed it in my work goes along with other strategies to get involved the community in different levels. So of course, I've been asked to paint murals at high schools, colleges, universities, and recently I've been asked to paint murals for community centers. And because of that, I've been having the experience of seeing the alternatives or the possibilities that we can do, especially with communities that they are creating their own residential units. And because of that, I like to see if we propose a public art form in which all these residential units that they are building for low-income housing will benefit from the public art in different ways, not only to enhance the identity of the community, not only to bring the historical elements of the community into those spaces, but also to add value to those low-income residential units. And that is the last proposal that I've been developing with the community. So to see in which way we can work with those organizations that they are building low income housing and create public art that not only enhance and unify the residential units for low income tenants, but also to see if we can, in one point, increase the value of those properties and beautify the units. So that is an alternative that we are having and I'm proposing for those residential units, and that is the last experience that I've been having. I'd like to show you the work that I've been doing, especially in those three different communities, the educational community with the universities and high schools, community centers, and also with the residential units, and in that way, I will show you how I'm getting involved with the community and also how the community have that input and bring a message in which the community express their identity through the murals, but also we have this element of reaffirming the historical aspects and avoid this kind of assimilation, because, well, I mean, basically what I was outlining on the title of this presentation is fight against this assimilation. So, because assimilation is a process of an alienation, also of different groups under the majority group, and by developing a strategy of integration, we are counteracting the assimilation process, that the assimilation process alienates everybody, and from the majority standpoint, decides what the rest of the people has to think, or the ways that of the culture is being modeled for those minorities. But if we develop a strategy of integration, the minorities will have their own ways to define themselves, rescue their own history, and at the same time, they will be part of the society. So we can see that in language. So the way to preserve Spanish as a language of the group, but at the same time, the use of English. So it's not because the Latinos are refusing to learn English. So it's because we like to speak Spanish whenever we want to speak Spanish, but at the same time, we will communicate in English because we know that is the common language. So especially now, Latinos are under attack from ultra-conservative groups. And basically, another strategy that I'm trying to do is to use art to bridge the minority groups to develop that kind of like cultural strategy to build those bridges of communication and understanding, in spite of the attack that we are been going through now, Latinos, especially with only English movement and with other actions of the ultra-conservative groups, mass deportations of people. And in that way, what I would like to see, what I like to express in my murals is to create this bridge of understanding. So, and I like to show you the works that I've been doing to basically to illustrate those ideas. But it's not working still. So
proposal in pencil, and this was the proposal that I did for the Memorial Union. And again, the message here, it was the history and also the path of the historical path of the Latino population, enhancing the importance of education. The building on the right is Oregon State University, and we have the past on the left, and on the right we have elements of the contemporary society, including Oregon State University. Then I continue working with similar subjects. This is for Portland Community College, for the PCC Rock Creek campus. And again, the image here that we have is elements of the historical background of the Latino population in particular, but also elements of the high-tech society in which we are living now, with elements of the building referring to Portland Community College and the Rockville campus. In these projects, the participation of the students has been important as well. This painting was executed for Halfway House in Hillsborough, and they asked me to bring a message of house and nesting. That was a way to underline the importance of a home and create a sense of belonging. This was for Canby School District and working with a summer program for middle schoolers. And again, we have here again the elements of education along with youth and children, bringing some elements of history of the community. Here with Parks and Recreation, it was a group of Latino students only, and they picked the images, and I put together all those images to create a narrative in which the different elements will bring the, a positive image. In this case, we have elements associated to drugs use and the positive aspects of the students get engaged in artistic activities, with elements of leaders of the community, like Emiliano Zapata. In this other work that I did was for this housing corporation, in which they commissioned me to paint this mural for one of the buildings. And again, I brought images of labor here. We have the fields as a ground in which we can see the living conditions of the people that they are depicted through the elderly and the children working in the fields. In one hand, and in the other side, we have the image of Cesar Chavez handling documents as a way to fight for workers' rights, and in this field we have elements of the ancient cultures emerging as a way to represents the relationship between cultivation and culture. Culture comes from cultivation, and culture is something that you have to cultivate constantly. So through the hard work of the people in the fields, we have this emerging of ancient cultures as a result. But in the same field, we have the new generation emerging out of those hard living conditions, and as a result of the struggle of the working class, and this youth. It becomes this tree of life in which we have the fruits that they are cocoons, and these cocoons emerge butterflies as a symbol of freedom. So the freedom is the result of, is the fruit of this tree that is the next generation of this struggle, social struggle. And basically that was the message. Recovering the local history of the labor movement in Oregon and with the migrant workers. And I tried to do it in a more metaphoric way, not to use the typical elements of, you know, the struggle and the fight, etc. So, but in a way that will appeal and use the butterfly as a symbol of freedom. And also the butterfly as a is not as only a symbol of freedom, but it's also a migrant insect that goes from Mexico into Canada and pass through the United States. So that is the freedom, the freedom of migration, the freedom of finding a place to live. So for me, that is important to use those symbols to reinforce that way of living in a way. I mean, but in good terms and good human conditions, and also in human conditions as well. So this is another work, in the same way that I did here with this project, for this corporation. I used the I took pictures of the children that I basically included here. So these are actual kids that they were living in the and at that place. And the same happens here with these students here. I tried to do a kind of collage of multicultural elements from different groups of students at David Douglas High School. And here, again, going back to the same corporation of housing, we have here another example of the history of the local leader, that was Cipriano Ferrer with Cesar Chavez here, and how this theme of education, because it's at the cultural center of the organization, how cultural education is related to political education. In that political education and cultural education, we have the tree of life. And again, here we have another migrant animals that in this case are swallows as a symbol of the migrant workers. And we have here the expression of different aspects of culture, because this is an educational center that also focuses on activities to of for kids, for children. And again, here we have the tree of life, using elements from the Mexican art craft tradition. And we have the two kids. Next to these other two images of children dancing from the Gulf Coast culture from Mexico. We're talking about these images from probably 200 AD. And basically, retaking the elements of children's happiness, playfulness, so that we're talking about from and for ancient times to nowadays, and basically bring the same. But with the difference now that we have computers, we have reading, we have sport activities, and expression of the arts in general. Here, this is another multicultural mural. I use the image of the tree of life, the arch tree of life, that the branches become the roots and the roots become the branches. In each of these branches, there are legends about education, and those legends about education emphasize the importance of education around the world in different languages. So we have language, we have in Japanese, in Chinese, in Arabic, in Farsi, in Greek, in Russian, in Tajik, in French, Spanish, English, and at the base we have the legend in Latin that education creates worlds. So I think that is very important, especially for the labor movement, the rise of education as well, and the rise of the access to education as well. So here this is the learning process, in which I also bring all these different writing systems up to the binary code, and how the binary code, instead of using the library, as traditional was used, we have the motherboard as a way to storage knowledge, and the learning process takes us ad infinitum to the exploration of the outer space, with here the Mars probe. This is a mural that I painted with Shizaka, and Shizaka invited me to be part of this team, and this is the entire mural. So in this section, and thank you for the invitation, Shizaka. And here we have other works that I did for Whitburn High School, and this is in relation to the subject of multiculturalism and different races. And so how different races take different elements for different cultures, and we have this kind of like similarities, emphasize similarities, and also common aspects. For example, the hairdresser of the Russian girls resonates in the hairdresser of Nefertiti from the past, that is coming from the past. And here from the present, we have the local community here with the school of Woodburn. And then elements of the contemporary society, how this long neck also resonates with the long neck of Nefertiti, and how this part of the dress of this kid also resonates with the sombrero of the Mexican charro. And also the different races here, and so how the races are also going around these faces of different colors, emphasizing the elements of diversity. This mural, probably we can see here the whole version. Oh, it's about the civil rights movement leaders. So, and this is the one of the half of the murals where we can see here the March of Humanity. I work with the students from Woodburn High School for another section of the Woodburn High School, and they were they wanted to include the wall between Mexico and United States, and so how the wall in the United States divides those two countries, and it's like a scar in the geography of this territory that shouldn't be divided in that way. And I think there's a lunacy that they are building a fence because attacks the ecology of the region, attacks is an attack, and we know that walls never work. Yeah, so we saw that in Berlin. And I don't know why still this country is so concerned about building more walls. Here we have the March of Humanity. In this March of Humanity, we have that they go through this gate that is a gate of history. We have all these civilizations, and Martin Luther King is alluding those civilizations. And we have elements from here. All these graduate leaders like Nelson Mandela in just a position with this Mayan mask that is fusing with this world that represents that there's no social justice without environmental also justice and ecology and the caring of the ecology. So both things has to be together. Like for example, I heard that also that there are some green movements that they don't acknowledge the participation or the inclusion of migrant workers. So it's something of concern that we need to be inclusive and we need to recognize the rights of the workers of any kind. So again, here we have the continuation of this leader. We have Rigoberta Menchú. We have Chief Joseph as a local leader. We're trying to bring elements of the local culture, like the City Hall in Woodburn. And from that institution emerged the image of Lincoln that is, along with the Statue of Liberty, the observance of this human rights and the civil rights as well. Again, a group of marching demonstrators also is part of the way to make effective the rights of the people. Here, there's another two works I did for Colonia Amistad. I used the logo and also to emphasize through this process the meaning of Amistad, that is friendship. And this is a mosaic work at the entrance. The neighbors in that section of Independence were opposed to have a low-income housing development because they decreased the value of their properties. So I said, well, why don't we create these elements of our public art so for them to see that in that way they will increase also the value of that area. So when they saw the work in tile, they were more accepting more the fact that they have this low-income housing development. And also we increase the value of the area as well. So. So that is a strategy of not only provide a place, a nice place for them to live, but also to increase the value. And for them, they feel also more identified with that place, and they will take care more of that place as well. So they will, for example, issues about or problems about graffiti will be deterred because the community will work and work unified once they have this kind of work, pieces of work. So, for example, this piece was in relation to, again, labor movement. We have, again, the working conditions of the people in the fields, especially here we have the kids picking onions here in the fields. We have the picket line with the workers. We have, I don't know if you identify this, this is the pioneer at the top of the Capitol in Salem as a way to demonstrate where for the rights, but at the same time as a marker of what is the political center of Oregon, but also a reference of the pioneer spirit in a way, because it's associated with that, the pioneer man is is represented this way. But I don't necessarily, of course, I recognize the importance and the symbolism of the pioneer men, but also I like to make this kind of like a juxtaposition of images with the picket line. And at the same time, bring the images that in Mexico is very popular, that is the Angel of Independence. I used before the Statue of Liberty as a way to make the observance of the civil rights. I'm here bringing the image of the Angel of Independence, that is the symbol of Mexico City, that is an angel of triumph for liberties. So finally, we have here the full circle, and then the spirit of Cesar Chavez again. Through, we have different primary color, people painting primary colors. We have a rainbow here, and he's coming out of that rainbow. That is basically the spirit of struggle and spirit of fighting for the rights of the people. So there's another work here, and this is a diptych. This is a two-piece mural. And the other side of the community center, I paint this. And this is through unity, the working, the agricultural workers here we have in one way also reaching to achieve education. And we have the youth as well, and this is Dolores Huerta, and the other we have Cesar Chavez, and Dolores Huerta are related as friends that they fought for the rights of the working, the agricultural workers in Oregon. So, and then we have this young lady here bringing the best of as a fruit, as a flower, as an offering, as a present of the best wishes of this unity between working class and students, basically, and in pursuit of achieving a better life conditions. Again, the pyramid in back represents a way to emphasize the ascending process. And we have here in the background with this sun and this sky, rays of birds in both directions, in blue towards the sun and in yellow from the sun, representing also freedom in this way too here. And probably this is the last one that I did for community center, for the visitor center in Wilsonville that depicts the history of Wilsonville, and I trying to be inclusive about bringing all these elements about Calapuya Indians and the presence of Alfonso Boone, and basically that is what I'm been working as a proposal for not only the inclusion of the community but also improving the living conditions and also bring value to the places, and in that way the community will take care more of their own, I would say, heritage, cultural heritage, but also preserve their history and help them to shape this kind of identity together. So, I feel proud about where they are living as well. So, mm-hmm. So do we have more? I don't know if you have some questions. Yeah.
Okay, I don't understand how the commission process works. If somebody wants to commission an artist, mm-hmm. where do they start?
Where did it start? Well, because they know already my works. At the beginning, they didn't know. They know that because I was working, I was studying art, basically. And they know me. But the commission process, it starts because you have a body of work that is a line of work that you are interested to work in. So pretty much if they are interested in this kind of work, because basically they would like to address issues about multiculturalism and other elements. So
I'm talking about the other end of it. I'm going through this process mm-hmm. in Boise, Idaho. Mm-hmm. I've got a grant from the City Arts Commission. Mm-hmm. $5,000, and I need to commission two or three artists mm-hmm. to do two or three murals on bus shelters. Mm-hmm. So how do I know nothing about art, I know nothing about how to contact an artist. How do I go through that process?
Well, if you don't know any artists around, and if you don't have any contacts to that, so well, the easiest way is to have a call for artists, and you can post that something on the newspaper. That will be like a very broad shot that you can do. The other option is go to the School of Art, and if they have something interest, but I really doubt it, because mural painting is seen here as a second-class work, art.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, that's
stupid. Well, yeah, I agree with you totally. But many people, because they think that it's associated with minorities, mural painting. It's associated. And besides that, it's associated is because it's minority, it's ethnic. And because it's ethnic, it's not the real thing in terms of art. So what we've been struggling is to show that, this is some form of art. Mm-hmm. And it can be as an important. We have to remember that we have works that Michelangelo did at the Sistine Chapel. And we have murals in temples, we have murals in churches. The difference that we have now is that the civil society is generating this kind of art for themselves, for itself. Mm-hmm. It's not the state anymore, it's not the church anymore, it's not those powerful institutions that they were before. So it's these grassroots organizations that they are doing that. So, and probably for you it's very difficult because you don't know. I mean, you are disconnected and you don't know how to read because you are in that position that you need to contact other elements and other sectors of the society. But I think that is part of the process, and it is very interesting. In my case, I can say that, yeah, I have people that they know me, but for you, that if you want to contact someone, in one of these cases, when I did for for Wilsonville, I saw an ad in the newspaper that, well, they were looking for an artist, but not necessarily mural artist. So an artist working for schools or in public art. Sometimes they don't even know about, for example, if they want to have a mural or what kind of mural, because there are different techniques. Many of these murals were painted on canvas. And it was in canvas because I proposed them, well, if I paint in canvas, you will have the options to remove the canvas. And then if you remodel the building or if you have modifications to the building, you can place it in another place. In another way, I tell them, so if you have, for example, an event, remember the political education mural with the different cultural activities mural site, that mural was placed in a cultural event in Woodburn that they were about, the cultural event was about corridos. And that was interesting because I told them, and you can use these murals as scenic paint, or as a background for an event and stage paint. There are other kind of murals that can be painted directly on wall, and they are not removable. But you can use different techniques. You don't need to go and paint directly on the wall. You can paint it on pieces of non-woven fabric, and then you just glue them. Uh-huh. Or you can paint directly. There are other murals that you can paint, or you can work with applications. Like, for example, you can work on mosaic. The term mural is very broad, and it's very flexible, flexible as the resources and techniques you have. So, but yeah, one of them, for example, like when, if you are wondering how to outreach for artists in the community, you can have a newspaper. It's very important for you that you are commissioned to see the portfolio of the artists and what exactly you have in mind. Sometimes it's very difficult to have knowledge about this kind of line of work. In many cases, I go to institutions that they are offering me this kind of commissions, so they don't have a clue about what is a mural. Sometimes they tell me, oh, the mural is going to be ready in 1 week. And I say, yeah, sure. So if you want tomorrow, yeah? And or sometimes I tell them, I mean, this depends on your schedule and your calendar year that you have at the school, or depends on the budget you have, depends on the dimensions of the mural, depends on so many things. So, but I usually work, and many of these works that I did is pretty much 16 feet by 7, 15. Because it's very transportable, you can handle very well those dimensions. You can move it from room to room or from building to building. But that is one option, for example. You can paint it on vinyls, on wood panels. You can paint it on canvas. You can paint it on even metal panels or sheets. You can paint it on hardiebacker.
Mm-hmm. On what?
Hardiebacker. So this is you know, the sheets that they use for building the walls, yeah? That they are like a made of concrete, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah. So you can paint it on that, so you can, they are heavy, but they can be movable, yeah.
Well, I checked the website for King County Transit in Seattle, and they said they put it on a top grade of plywood, because it has to be in panels to fit in the bus shelter.
Yeah. And yeah, that is another option. For example, plywood, so that you can put it on wood, yeah, and 4x8 sheets. Usually the dimensions, and based on that, so the size of it, of the wall that you would like to do.
What would be a working wage or a living wage kind of thing for to offer for a mural, 4 foot by 8 foot?
It's very flexible. I mean, depending on the experience of the artist. I don't want below $35 per hour. So, and commissions for me, no less than $4,000 commission. So I include everything. I include usually when I go to schools and or community centers, I include presentation. I include the involvement of the community. I include background and presentations about the art history movement, mm-hmm. and of the mural movement. And then we work on the painting process. So, and the implementation.
Uh-huh.
So yeah, and but that is what I offer as a whole package, a workshop. So I don't offer just the product. So sometimes if they ask me just for the product, it will be fine for me. It will be fine for me. So, but because I'm dealing usually with community centers and with schools, they like to see more of that component of the instructional component.
Thank you.
Any other question? No? Okay. Well, thank you very much for your...
I want to make a little comment. It's just that, you know, I know how powerful it is to create vision, you know, for us to move forward in our society. And so many people are always talking about only the problem. But, you know, it's been proven that science fiction from generations before now has contributed to the technology we have today. You know, so this is really inspiring, the type of artwork that you are doing to create a much more positive community, much more inclusive.
Thank you very much. Yeah, I hope I can bring that those elements of bridging different cultures, because you know that it's not that difficult, especially during this kind of environment. And sometimes when I've been painting murals, they go to the major, especially in Ceylon, when I was painting the mural with the tree, and they were complaining that they were vandalizing, or we were doing graffiti stuff on the walls until the mayor saw the proposal.
Mm-hmm.
So public art is it's a very easy target, but especially when we are doing with minorities, and these minorities on minorities under attack, so it's kind of difficult, and it's not the first time I see that. So
does anyone know the law in the Portland area about murals? There's been so much debate about murals sizes or...
Well, hopefully we will have some kind of reform. They're going to do a series of modifications. I've been getting informed on that too. In a way, and one another way. Initially, a group of people through Metro Murals, through Portland Mural Defense. Also, Isaac was participating in that process. We submitted recommendations for the actual program that is now in place, the public art program. But the thing is that that was a reaction of the lawsuit that the city has from Clear Channel, because Clear Channel was suing for $1 million the city, because they were claiming that they were discriminated against. Because the city was granting this funding to local artists, so.
But what's what?
The ruling of the judge at the end, because the judge at the beginning ruled in favor of Clear Channel, and then the city submit an appeal. And then, and that process of appeal from 1998 or something like that to last year, I think, the judge ruled in favor of the city. So finally, it was in favor of the city. Because they, at that time, the mural program was already, the new mural program was already in place. And what we're trying to do is now to submit recommendations to have a new mural, another new mural program that is not based on this reaction against the lawsuit of Cliff Chandler. So that it will be more inclusive, that will be less problematic for building owners, that will be more easy in terms of the relationship between the building owners and the artists and the community, and also to see that if it's possible, RAC has a more ease this process as well if the artist seeks funding from RAC as well. Because at this point, it is perceived for many people that RAC is this kind of like a ruling entity about what is good or what is bad in terms of art in Portland. And people in the community, artists in the community, we don't need that. So basically, what we need is to generate art and keep painting. And with less obstacles, the better. So, and I think that is something that we are hoping that we will change, if it's possible, through this action of these organizations, Portland Mural Defense, among others, yeah. And so hopefully we will see some changes next year.
But right now there are many murals around town.
Yeah.
Why are those allowed and other murals aren't?
Well, there are two reasons. There are many murals that they were not allowed, especially in Alberta area, yeah. That they are very typical community murals there. And so the people start doing that, so that is fine. I mean, it's part of the people, I will. So the city, technically, many of those murals are illegal.
Yeah.
And the city can take action at any moment, if they want. So the other thing is because this new regulation is already passed, so let's see how the sign code will affect them, and how the sign code, the entity that regulates the sign code, would allow them as well. So, many of the other murals went through the process of RAC for approval, and it was problematic in one piece, that was the easement part. So that the owner of the building has to sign an easement to state that the mural was a property of the city. I mean, the material thing is the property of the owner, yeah, of the building. But the image and the skin, outside skin, was the property of the city through that easement. We're trying to avoid the use of easement because it should be a relationship between the artist and the owner of the building.
Sure.
Unless the RAC is funding, but yeah, that would be another case, yeah.
You're saying, what are you saying, your RAC?
RAC. It's RAC, Regional Art and Culture and Council. And of Portland here. Yeah, so I think this is it.
Who is that in the upper left-hand corner?
Left corner, right on the corner,
yeah.
Is Zapata.
Oh, okay.
Zapata. Remember one of the murals I have is kind of like a guy with a big sombrero? That is Zapata.
Well, yeah,
but
look, this big and with a saffron.
Yeah, so, sorry about that. I mean, I wish I had the slideshow, but you know all these technical things.
Yeah. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you.